In this powerful two-disc teaching series, the entire Roe family will teach you simple principles on how to maintain or create a successful family.
We're making an attempt to help people to get their houses in order so that the blessing of God would overtake that house. Amen.
The husband is to love the wife as Christ has loved the church. Well, how did he love the church? You're supposed to literally give your life to that home life. You're supposed to give your life to your family.
Parents ought to provide for their children, not their children having to go get a job and provide for them.
You got to understand, your presence alone will change things for them. Just you, I don't care if your kid doesn't play sports, if they are in the school play, but you being there, them feeling your affirmation and feeling that love, man, it's priceless. You can't beat it.
For your love gift of $15, we will rush this series right out to you. But when your gift is $25 or more, we will send you Order in the House, Volumes 1 and 2. Call 504-245-9060. Or log on to www.theubc.org. Call or go online today.
Let's join Dr. Roe for the message already in progress.
And then we found out that it's very important to pray. He said to pray the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers. Now, we're not praying that God would save them. Listen closely. We're not praying that God would save them. That's not the instruction. See, God does not need to do anything more for anybody else to experience salvation. Salvation is available to all men. It's available to all men, all women, all children, race, creed, color. It does not matter. It's available and it's waiting because the work for salvation to be made available has already been done. Jesus himself said it on the cross. It is finished.
Amen.
So we don't pray and ask God to save anybody.
Amen.
Because the work is already done.
Amen.
He said to pray that God would raise up laborers because the laborers are few. So pray to God consistently that he will continue to raise up laborers, people who are willing to step into the work and do the work of preaching the gospel, of reaching the lost. And so where there are no laborers, there's not going to be any harvest. And so God wants his harvest. He calls the harvest the precious fruit of all the earth. So he wants that harvest to come in. He wants that precious fruit of all the earth to come into the kingdom of God. It is his harvest. And so it takes laborers to win souls, but it's not hard labor. It's not hard. Jesus said, take my yoke, for it is what?
Easy.
And my burden is what?
Light.
And so if you're doing something the way Jesus did it, it is not going to be burdensome. It is not going to be such a heavy yoke that you cannot accomplish it. If in fact you find it extremely difficult to be a laborer concerning reaching the lost, you're doing something wrong. You have not learned. He said, come learn of me. You have not learned. And when you don't know how to do something, it's very hard. Is that right?
Yeah. Amen.
You ever tried to put together something, you know, and a box came out of a box, a bicycle or something, and you didn't read the manual? And somewhere along the line, it got real hard.
Amen.
And so life is that way. When you don't know the word of God and obey the word of God, then life can get hard.
Yep.
I wish somebody can say amen to that.
Yep.
And so let's take a look at several things, because we pointed out in our last lesson that there are several things that will help you to become a great soul winner. I don't want you just to become a soul winner. I want you to become a great soul winner. Somebody shout, I will be,
a
great soul winner. Say it again,
I will be
a great soul winner. If you have faith to say it, say this, I am
a great
soul winner. Now, so in order to be a great soul winner, number one, you must understand or know that you are reconciled. The word reconciled means that you have been made right with God. That means that you are now in harmony with God. He has settled all issues that he had with you. It's a done deal. He's settled. He's not going to settle them. He's settled them. In other words, God has looked at your past sin. He's looked at your present sin. He's looked at your future sins, and he's looked at your sin nature. and he has dealt with it once and for all. I wish somebody could shout amen.
Amen.
Is that not too good to be true? It is too good to be true news that God has already dealt with every one of your issues. But the main thing he's dealt with is your nature. And since he has dealt with your nature and he has converted your nature and he now calls you righteous because he has made you to be righteous in his sight. So as far as God is concerned, you are the righteousness of God in Christ.
Amen.
Somebody shout, I am the righteousness
of God
in Christ. Now we dealt with that extensively last week, but this week we want to move a little bit further. So number two, if I'm going to be a great soul winner, number two, I must love others the way God has loved me.
Amen.
I must love others the way God has loved me. How has God loved me? He's forgiven me. The very first thing that he's done to prove his love is he's forgiven me. And he forgave me without stipulation. In other words, he did not put any stipulations on it. He did not tell me if I would do 25 jumping jacks. He did not tell me if I come and paint the church building. He did not say if you make the pastor gumbo, if you make the pastor a good pound cake. He did not say any of those things. But what he has said and has done is that he has totally forgiven you. And so now he wants you to deal with people that way. He wants you to forgive people. He doesn't want you holding grudges. See, because forgiveness is something you grant someone. Nobody can earn forgiveness. Nobody can earn forgiveness. I wish somebody could say that with me. Nobody,
nobody
can earn forgiveness. Now, trust is something different. Don't confuse the two. See, now, I have to earn trust. I have to prove, if I've failed in my trust, I have to prove my trust. Because let me tell you something. If your name Lil Johnny, and you went by your cousin them house, and their house caught on fire,
amen.
And then you went by your second cousin house, and their house caught on fire, you ain't coming by my house, Johnny.
Hallelujah.
How many of y'all gonna let Johnny come to y'all house? See, Johnny can't be trusted with fire. Is that right? And so we have to have Johnny to prove himself. But when it comes to forgiveness, forgiveness is something that is granted. You cannot earn forgiveness. You can't earn it. That's why God forgave you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody shout, I'm forgiven. Now, so I must love others the way God has loved me. And one of the things that comes out of loving others the way God has loved me is that I long for their salvation. I long for in the pit of my heart. I want them. There's a heartfelt desire in me that I want to see them.
Amen.
I want to see them in the kingdom.
Yeah.
I want to see them living for God.
Amen.
And so Romans chapter 1, turn there with me. Romans chapter number 1. I'm sorry, Romans 9, verse number 1. Romans chapter 9, verse number 1. Got the Bible answer, man. He got it right. All right, praise the Lord. Notice this. In verse 1, I'm going to go all the way to verse 3. He says, I say the truth in Christ. I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. Now, the Apostle Paul is writing to the church at Rome. He says that he wishes that he himself could be cursed so that they might be saved, but he recognizes that that's not reality. He's just saying that I would go that far. I want them saved so badly, I would go that far, but he recognizes it is not by his might nor his power, but it is only by the grace of God. But he is so concerned about, notice, his brethren, my kinsmen, my auntie, my nanan, my paran, people who are related to me, my fellow countrymen. He's really concerned in this instance. He is speaking about the nation of Israel. He is an Israelite. The Apostle Paul is an Israelite. And he is, look, desiring that Israel would be saved. I don't know if you ever pray and call out for America to be saved. I don't know if you ever declare that America must be saved. Years ago, I was in Zimbabwe, Africa, and they had this song, and they were singing, if you believe and I believe and together we pray, the Holy Spirit must come down and Africa must be saved.
Amen.
You know, these people have heart. They're so passionate about their nation. They recognize the difficulties and the trouble. And so I look at all of the trouble. I turn on the TV, on the news, and I see African Americans, of which I'm a part of, and I see them dying day in and day out. And so my heart's prayer and desire is that African Americans got to be saved. So if you believe and I believe, and together we pray, the Holy Spirit of God will come down and African Americans will be saved. Come on, somebody. If Paul could pray it for his kinsmen, you and I ought to be able to pray it for our kinsmen. I wish somebody had a better shout than that. See, you got to love people. Love them so much so that you would pray for them when they don't even know you're praying. When you would pray for people you don't know personally, but just because you come out of that tribe.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Some of y'all come from uptown, you need to pray for the uptown people. Some of y'all come from the ninth ward, you need to be praying that the ninth ward would be saved.
Yes.
Hallelujah. In Romans chapter 10, excuse me. Get the Grey Poupon back on it. Romans chapter 10 and verse number 1. Notice what Paul is praying once again. He says, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Not that God would save them, but that they would recognize that the work has been finished. Didn't Jesus say on the cross it is finished?
Yes. Yes.
In other words, he was saying everything that's necessary for any man to be saved, it's done already.
Hallelujah.
And so now it's not a matter of God doing something, it's a matter of man doing something.
Hallelujah.
It's a matter of you receiving, because this is now your receiving day.
Yes.
How many recognize that this is your receiving day?
Yes.
Now, when he was on that cross, not only did he provide eternal life for you, but your healing was on that cross. Your peace has been placed on that cross. I don't care what you're worrying about, bring it to the cross, because your peace is on that cross. Your joy is now on that cross. Come on now. And your prosperity is on that cross. I'll never be broke another day, because all my bills already been nailed to the cross. And so he says, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved, for I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. See, there are a lot of people out here have a zeal for God, but it is not according to knowledge. We know that there are all forms of religion out here, but there's some forms of religion, they have no mention of Jesus at all. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can get to the Father but by me. And these, if you notice with all of these religions, they may refer to him as God, but they never refer to him as Father. And the reason for that is because they're not in the family. See, they recognize that God is their creator, but they don't know that God would like to become their Father. Are you listening to me? No man can call him Father lest you be born again. See, you can tell when a man is not saved because he calls him God. He won't call him Father. But I say, Father God, hallelujah. I say, you are my Father and Jesus is my brother. And my question, is he kin to you?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Somebody, come on, touch somebody and tell them, Jesus is my brother. Is he kin to you? What they said. Praise the Lord, amen. See, God wanted a family. He still wants, and he likes a lot of children.
Amen.
Come on, say amen to that.
Amen.
And so there's plenty of room at his table. So don't think there won't be enough at the table if you come in the family.
Yeah.
There's still more than enough.
Yeah.
He is the God of more than enough.
Yes, he is.
But you can hear these others, you can hear the Mormons speak, you can hear Jehovah's Witness speak, Hare Krishna, Sun Young Moon, all of these various groups who are trying to tell you ways to get to God. But there may be a lot of ways to get to God, but ain't but one way to get to the Father.
Yeah.
Amen.
Jesus said, I'm that way.
Yeah.
No man can come to the Father but by me. Hallelujah. See, because God wants a family. And so in order to get in a family, you got to be born into it. See, you got to be born. You either got to be born through natural birth or you got to be born by adoption. Hallelujah. You got to come through adoption. Well, we've been adopted.
Yes, I have.
I said all of us been adopted.
Yeah.
But thank God we're in the family.
I'm in the family.
And how you know we're in the family? I got the name. Come on.
Yes.
The name that's above every name, the name of Jesus. And so he said, for I bear them record that they have a zeal for God. A lot of people got zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. See, then in other words, they got wrong information. For they being ignorant, ignorant means without, being ignorant of God's righteousness. See, there is the righteousness of man, and then there's the righteousness of God.
Amen.
But the Bible says the righteousness of man is as filthy rags before God. In other words, you trying to be perfect in and of your own self, according to your own flesh, is as filthy rags before God. And that's why when you receive Jesus, you become the righteousness of God in Christ. Somebody shout, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. In other words, he made me righteous. I cannot make myself righteous no matter how many quote unquote right acts that I do. Righteousness is a gift from God. And so when God sees you as righteous, then you become acceptable in his sight. And he sees you as righteous when you accept Jesus. When the blood of Jesus is on your life, God sees you as his righteousness. You stand complete in him.
Amen.
Glory to God. You stand complete in him when he sees you through the blood of Jesus Christ. And so these people were going about, like all religions, they're trying to make a way of righteousness. In other words, if you stand on the corner in 100 degree heat and you hold up this little booklet, that's righteousness. Not in the kingdom of God, but in the kingdom of religion. See, and it's amazing how these religions get people to do all kinds of things. They lay on nails. Some of them walk on glass for the sake of trying to get to God. But God said that if you accept his gift, Jesus the Christ, who has taken the whipping for you, why would you want to go to jail when somebody else will take your charge? But see, what they're trying to do, you know, just like I grew up in the Catholic Church, man, you had to grow up the stairs and get your knees needed to bleed sometime. And if you wanted some money, you had to put a bean in your pocketbook on St. Joseph Day. And if you wanted your house not to flood, you had to put some bread on the altar.
Yeah.
I don't mean money bread. I mean some bread. Are you listening to me? And so, and you may have come up with, you know, and you have to light candles for this and candles for that.
Yeah.
See, but my God says in him, I'm complete.
Yeah.
The work is finished. Glory to God. My joy is finished. My peace, no matter what's going on in my life, I got still a right to some peace. Still got joy. Tell your neighbor, I've been through hell and back, but I still got joy. And the joy of the Lord is your strength. If you ain't got no joy, you ain't got no strength. I said, you have no joy, you have no strength. See? And so I've got to learn how to love people, and I've got to love them the way God has loved me. John 15 and 12, quickly go there with me. John 15 and 12. Notice what it says. It says in verse 12, in the 15th chapter of the book of John, this is the Gospel of John, it says, this is my commandment, this is Jesus speaking, that you love one another as I have loved you. And notice what he says here, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. The word friend is their covenant, those who he's in covenant with. He lays his life down for them. Are you listening to me? So one of the things that you can't be is, if you're going to love people, you can't be judgmental of people. Many of you saw the little promotional piece that we had in our video announcements, where the one gentleman sitting on the park bench had the glasses on and looked all clean cut, and the other gentleman had tattoos on, and he had the drumsticks in his hand, and he had the mohawk haircut. Most of us, when we saw that video clip, we probably thought that the unsaved one was the one with the mohawk. Yeah. Didn't we? Yeah. Didn't we?
Yes.
Because you were being judgmental. You are walking by sight. Mm. And whenever you are walking by sight, you cannot please God.
Amen.
For if you're going to please God, you must walk by faith and not by
sight.
Come on, church. You got to walk by faith and not by what?
Sight.
Yes, indeed. See, so you cannot judge a book by its cover.
Uh-huh.
You would think that most of you have lived long enough to realize you can't judge a book by its cover.
Yeah.
You can't go around. See, like there's some people who would say, what kind of preacher got orange shoes on? I know some of y'all out there judging me, but that's all right. Jesus still saved me. Amen. So you know, how come you don't have a tie on? See, all that old outer, you trying to judge something from the outside.
Yeah.
How is it okay for you not to wear a tie, but I got to wear a tie? Well, you're the preacher. See, when you have preconceived ideas
yeah.
about what how does a saved man look?
Right.
How does a man feel with the Holy Ghost look?
Yeah.
Amen. So don't be confused and don't be judgmental, because when you're judgmental, you're not walking in love towards people. And there are people who will make hell and miss heaven because you were judgmental. We don't want nobody to have their blood on our hands. We had an opportunity to win them to Jesus, but because they were smelling, oh, get that old stanky self from around me.
Amen.
Just because a person is smelling one way don't mean they don't smell good to God. They may have been an angel and you didn't know it. Because the Bible says that be careful how you treat people, because you may be entertaining angels unaware. You may be entertaining an angel and you think it's some old stinky homeless person. But because you're so high and mighty, because you got all your PhDs and master's degrees, post hole diggers. Come on, PhD, post hole digger. Don't get caught up. See, don't get caught up in, because you finally arrived and you got your little 3-bedroom house with your little carport. I forgot, y'all got garages now. Yeah, and got your little garage and don't even know your neighbor's name. And if you know their name, you talk bad, you call them out their name. You say that blank neighbor of mine. You say bad things about your neighbor. You're always looking over here. Well, show them something. Show them some Jesus. Amen. No. You know, when I grew up in the neighborhood where everybody knew everybody, and if somebody needed a cup of sugar, they could come and knock on anybody's door in the immediate neighborhood, and they could get their immediate need met. But nowadays, you better not come. You send the dogs on them. Fido, go get them. I don't know what they want. Go get them, Fido. No, we've got to come back to the place where we walk in love with people.
Amen.
We care about people and we serve people.
Yeah.
We must love them the way God has loved us. And that, you know, God loved you enough to not judge you falsely. To not judge you falsely. See, many times we want to sit on these big old high judgment seats and we want to judge others, but we never take time to look in the mirror to judge ourselves. Is that right? I tell your neighbor, you know you're not perfect. What they said. They said something back to you? Amen. No. Jesus is the perfect one. Is he not the perfect one? And so since Jesus is the perfect one, we're to follow his example. And Jesus sometime was known to hang out with wine bibbers.
Yes.
Amen. Why? Not for the purpose of trying to get wine, but he's running and getting them saved.
Yes.
Bring them into the kingdom. Jesus will hang out sometime with the woman at the well, and the other disciples, they judged her because they said, Samaritans and Jews don't have any dealings. Jesus, what you doing even talking to her? Well, you know how in New Orleans, in different parts of the country, even within the African American race, we got problems with each other color.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh, it's quiet up in here.
Amen.
Amen. Some young lady one time told me, she said, Vanilla Men is out. It's the dark man time. I said, I'm a spirit. I have a soul. I just live in this body. You ain't even seen the real me. Come on, somebody. They have not seen the real you. They know not. That's why Jesus said, forgive them. They don't know what they're talking about. But the same love that is shown to you must be shown to the sinner. The same love that was shown to you must be shown to the sinner. You cannot be judgmental because the same price that was paid for the preacher was paid for the pimp. The same blood that saved the preacher can save the pusher. Come on, somebody. I said the same blood. Somebody shout the same blood. Nah, y'all ain't shouting enough for me. I said the same blood. See, the same blood that saved the pastor can save the prostitute. Lord have mercy.
In this powerful two-disc teaching series, the entire Roe family will teach you simple principles on how to maintain or create a successful family.
We're making an attempt to help people to get their houses in order so that the blessing of God would overtake that house. Amen.
The husband is to love the wife as Christ has loved the church. Well, how did he love the church? You're supposed to literally give your life to that home life. You're supposed to give your life to your family.
Parents ought to provide for their children, not their children having to go get a job and provide for them.
You got to understand, your presence alone will change things for them. Just you, I don't care if your kid doesn't play sports, if they are in the school play, but you being there, them feeling your affirmation and feeling that love, man, it's priceless. You can't beat it.
For your love gift of $15, we will rush this series right out to you. But when your gift is $25 or more, we will send you Order in the House, Volumes 1 and 2. Call 504-245-9060. Or log on to www.theubc.org. Call or go online today.